If you're someone with a software development background or you used Unity for quite some time, then you've probably heard about singletons. Maybe have already used them and even experienced the benefits and drawbacks they bring with them. I'm the creator of the game called Snappy Mouse Run, and in this video we will talk about why so many developers turn to one of the most controversial software design patterns more often when developing in Unity. In the object-oriented programming world, a singleton is called an instance of an object that exists only once and is accessible basically from anywhere within your project and beyond. Because they're so easy to access from anywhere, the programmer does not need to worry about passing them around. They are always within reach, just there to grab. A single, elegant one-liner and the job is done. These global objects are a lazy programmer's dream and a refactoring nightmare. The singleton software design pattern is often called an anti-pattern, a bad practice, and even a virus that spreads through the codebase. But why, if it's so convenient and simple and elegant? And it is, at first. Here a reference, there a reference, everything works, but it makes your code unreusable, tailored specifically for this one use case inside the application. It makes the code dependent on the singleton state, and without getting rid of the singleton dependency, it's nearly impossible to componentize your code into smaller independent entities that could be used in other scenarios, even in other projects. But what if you don't think about reusing your code? Well, probably you want to make sure it works properly. How do you know if it works properly? Testing. Best practice is to identify the smallest chunks of functionality that make sense to test and test them independently. These are so-called unit tests. But how can you identify independent units if everything depends on the singleton? All of a sudden, the smallest independent unit becomes the whole application. In that case, the only thing you can do is to test the whole application with workflow tests, which can be very long, very resource intensive, and are very hard to debug. If you're lucky, the error happens at the beginning of the workflow, and if you're not, maybe you have to wait for hours to reproduce it. But come on, these are extremes. You have your testers, they will find all the bugs in no time, they always do. Well, if not testing, then you most probably need good performance. Multithreading is a good way to boost performance. In case of multithreading, where multiple threads are accessing the singleton, it can be a serious performance killer. Not to mention that the singleton must be concurrent proof, or it could be a possible source of race conditions and deadlocks. In such concurrent access scenarios, singletons are generally a recipe for disaster and should be avoided. But still, with so many arguments against it, developers are still using them, and there is one particular industry where they are used more often than in any other. It's the gaming industry and Unity in particular. But why? Are game developers especially lazy? Don't they care about componentization, testing and performance? Of course they do, but there is a very good reason why the singleton pattern is so widely used and accepted among Unity game developers. You see, in other projects, you keep track of your instantiated objects and classes from the beginning on. You have a clear entry point. First, you would initialize some framework you are using, create your manager and controller objects, and then keep track of any other object you create along the course of the application. Now let's look at Unity. Since Unity is heavily focused on visuals, you're actually building your code around those visuals. You're forced to think about code like it's something secondary, something that just glues things together, just some kind of support, not the main driver. The main driver is the Unity engine. So what you end up doing is you inject your object behavior code that triggers and executes at certain points, and you leave the control of the object's lifecycle to the engine. You don't have a clear defined entry point, the engine initializes itself and acts like a manager that from time to time executes your behavior code. While this doesn't seem so different from other frameworks out there, the main difference is that other frameworks restrict your code snippets to be independent of each other. Take a REST server, for example, that handles requests. Every request is served independently. The requests are not designed to interfere with each other, and if they do, it's a bug. In contrast, Unity allows interaction between objects, so you end up with a bunch of objects that have dependencies to each other. The problem is that at the same time, Unity gives very limited possibilities to manage those dependencies, to keep track of your objects. There are a few approaches in Unity to tackle this problem. First, you create the scene and all the objects in the scene using the Unity editor and use the inspector to assign the dependencies. You pick dependencies between objects by hand. With a small number of objects, this is very easy to do. Drag and drop, easy. But as the number rises, what happens is you quickly lose overview and end up with a very messy inspector. Manually rearranging or tweaking the dependencies becomes a time-consuming and frustrating task with a high tendency to create errors. Also, it's easy to break the object and suddenly lose all dependencies. Even if you did manage to become an inspector guru, keeping track of the changes you are doing in the inspector over the course of the project, it's a problem on its own. Source control doesn't help much either. The changes are stored into so-called meta files, which is not a particularly friendly format. So you end up searching for other ways to export the inspector into human readable format and even take screenshots as a last resort. As you can imagine, this approach of handling dependencies is not very scalable. It is also worth noting that there are customized inspectors out there that tackle those issues, but it mainly comes down to mitigating the symptoms of a messy inspector rather than curing the main problem, which is dependency management. The second approach is similar to the first one, but instead of using the inspector, every object looks for dependencies in the scene by itself. So every object has a sort of custom written dependency resolver, which searches the scene for its dependencies by some attributes or tags. This approach leaves the inspector clean and does provide a better way of keeping track of the changes if you're doing it right, but still, this applies only for the code part. The big problem with both of those approaches is that the application does not break if you mess up the scene or references. You don't get a compiler error. So you often don't even notice that you have accidentally messed up the references while simply moving objects in the scene hierarchy or even just renaming objects. That's a huge deal. You can mess things up without even touching the code. And as mentioned, tracking changes in the editor isn't the easiest. The third approach is to take matters into your own hands and instantiate all of the objects in code yourself rather than letting the engine take care of it. That's what you would do in other non-Unity projects with your manager and controller classes, which keep track of your objects. Since Unity is so visual, by instantiating everything yourself, you're basically working blindly and get to see the results only after you start your application. It's common to semi-randomly generate objects around the scene, like rocks, plants, and other decorative things, but it is seriously challenging to procedurally generate the whole scene from an empty one. Moreover, not every game concept is suitable for procedural generation, and forcing it can make the game overly complicated to develop, maintain, and will sure add up to the development cost. The benefit is, though, that you don't have to worry about searching your object dependencies, since they are managed entirely in code at the time when you are instantiating them. You also don't need to worry about keeping track of the changes, since it's handled the traditional way, using source control. Remember what benefit a singleton brings? Being globally accessible. So by being globally accessible, other objects don't need to search for it. They just grab the reference from a public static property and are done. It's type proof, checked by the compiler, you get a compiler error if you mess something up, you don't need to deal with the inspector, tracking changes is done by source control, and you can still build your scene in the editor rather than procedurally generating and working blindly only to see the finished scene when actually starting the game. What's the conclusion? Should you start better managing the inspector, restrict changes in the editor, procedurally generate the whole scene, or give yourself a break and use the controversial singleton pattern? Probably most people will agree that the combination of those approaches is the way to go, with a tendency towards procedural generation and away from singletons. In my opinion, dealing with the inspector just brings too many problems in bigger projects, and although I learned the singleton drawbacks the hard way, using them in Unity on a limited scale and combining them with a proper loose coupling mechanism could mitigate some of the drawbacks. This approach and similar design patterns we will look at in the coming videos. Also, we'll take some real-world examples from the game Snappy Mouse Run to see how some of the problems were solved there. Using Unity, a singleton seems like a not-so-bad solution for a lot of problems. It's no wonder that game developers are using them so often. And whether we like that or not, as long as Unity has its limitations, singletons are here to stay for sure. So better be prepared to encounter some, if not explicitly in your code, then probably in some third-party packages. Let me hear your thoughts. Write them in the comments down below. Also, you'll find the link in the description to the Mono Singleton class that I used in my projects. As always, give a like and subscribe if you found this video useful and want to see more content like this, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye.